What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Cars, Costs, and Technology. On today's video, we're going to be doing the first ever Q&A here on the channel. I did put a post up on Instagram as well as YouTube earlier this week asking for some good questions that we could cover in today's video, and I really appreciate all the participation and great responses that we got to those posts. We got a lot of great topics that we can cover today. I do want to point out that due to time constraints, I'm not going to be answering every question that was submitted. I do want to answer these questions very thoroughly, so some of them will be left off. If you don't see your question answered on today's video, I will make sure that I personally respond to you wherever the question was submitted. And again, I do appreciate everyone's responses and participation in this. Now, I do think that I will be doing more Q&A videos in the future. I feel like it's a cool format for us to talk about multiple topics rather than dedicating an entire video to just one topic. I will still do those, but I like the Q&A format, and I think that you guys are going to enjoy this video as well. Now, with that being said, let's go ahead and dive into the questions. I'm going to start out with one that was submitted on YouTube, and that is, why did you go with an automatic when you are an enthusiast and know how to drive stick? So this is a question that I get really often. Sometimes it's not always in question form, but more so somebody who's upset, getting pretty vocal in the comments and saying some unnecessary things. So I wanted to address this topic from multiple angles and hopefully help diffuse this topic or situation. And I think that trying to influence somebody's transmission preference or choice is similar to trying to influence their, you know, favorite paint color or something like that. You know, it really boils down to how the car is going to be used and what your personal preference is. For me, I daily drive my Corvette, so I feel like the 8-speed auto was a more consistent option for me, a little more practical for me to drive the car on a daily basis. But I also want to show you guys some numbers that there's more Corvette owners that feel that way than you might think. You know, some of you that follow this channel may be interested in Corvettes, but maybe not. It's not your passion. It's not something that you follow on a regular basis, and you're not very familiar with all the detailed numbers. And I'm a numbers guy, so I want to share these with you. So we can see from 2014 all the way to 2018, I've got the production numbers here, and this is for all Corvette models across the lineup. You can see that there was a drastic difference in the amount of automatic Corvettes sold than manuals. Now, this is not meant to undermine manual transmissions. I've reviewed multiple manual transmission vehicles, and I think that there is certainly some appeal to the extremely engaging driving feeling when you're using a manual transmission. I really do feel like there's value in that, and I'm certainly not discouraging anyone from getting a manual transmission. I'm more or less just validating, you know, that a automatic is a good option, and that I do think that you'll be impressed with it based on the fact that so many other Corvette owners are choosing this option and obviously seem to be happy with their cars. So you can see, not only was the trend, you know, right out of the gate from 2014 with the 7th generation or C7 Corvette drastically more automatic sold, but then as you go on the line, you can see that it continually increases, you know, as far as the percentage of automatic sold versus the amount of manual sold. Now, you may be wondering, well, why is this? Why would that trend go that way, other than just the fact of maybe people not knowing how to drive stick? But I do think that most people interested in buying a Corvette are probably able to drive stick. I don't think it's that. I think it's, again, it boils down to the practicality of the transmission, the consistency. I'm going to use the C7 Z06 as a reference point. We're going to look at some performance numbers. When you look at a manual equipped Z06 as well as an automatic equipped Z06 and look at some of its performance numbers as far as 0 to 60 and quarter mile times, you can see that the automatic is quicker. Now, these times, I'm sure, these are actually posted in a GM press release, and I'm sure that these were recorded and verified with a professional driver behind the wheel. So you can imagine, without a professional driver behind the wheel of the manual car, just how much faster the automatic would be. And I know it's not all about speed. You know, for some, it's about the driving feel, you know, getting out there and having fun with your car. And I absolutely agree. So again, I want to reiterate, if you enjoy manual transmissions, absolutely go pick one up. They're a great transmission. You'll enjoy it. You'll save some money. It's a fantastic option. But for those of you that want to go with an automatic, I don't think that at this point in time, you know, with the amount of automatics being sold and the performance increases, that anyone needs to feel like it's any less of a Corvette because it's got an automatic transmission. And it seems like that for some people that are putting, you know, nasty comments below, that they just don't think it's quite competing. But you can see here all the numbers line up to show that in every way, you know, not only in terms of popularity, but also in terms of performance, consistency, you name it, the automatic is a very good option and seems to be here to stay and increasing in popularity over time. I think part of the appeal of a Corvette is the fact that, you know, your average guy can go out, pick one up, and experience race car like performance without a great deal of experience or a lot of money. And I think that the automatic even adds to that experience, giving, you know, even somewhat inexperienced drivers the ability to feel some of that performance and that power. Obviously, you want to be careful if you don't have a whole lot of experience with that kind of power. But again, the manual may be even more intimidating for people who are new to sports cars or getting into something like a Corvette. So anyway, I don't want to rant on about this topic because I probably could talk for too long, but I hope that you guys see where I'm coming from and that nobody sees this as an attack on manual transmissions. This is simply putting the data out there. You can interpret it how you will. I'm more or less just answering this gentleman's question, and I hope that I have validated some of the reasoning behind so many automatic Corvettes being sold. So let's go ahead and move on to the next question, and that's going to be, would you upgrade the aero on the car or maybe upgrade to a Z51? So my Corvette actually does have the spoiler that comes on with the Z51 package. So there's not a drastic difference in terms of appearances with my base Stingray versus a Z51 Corvette. I don't think that I would necessarily sell my Corvette to get a Z51 because of that reason. There's not a great deal of differences in the appearance. Now, there are a lot of performance upgrades, which I would like to have, but not quite enough to justify actually selling the car to get, you know, another Stingray with a slightly different equipment group. Now, as far as adding an aero to my existing Corvette, I do think that, say, something like a front splitter or side rockers would look really good on my car. I'm not opposed to that. My only problem is, and I'm going to give you guys more details on this later, but there may be a new Corvette that I have my sights set on, so I don't want to put money into aero on my existing one and not get that money back out when it comes time to resell the car. But again, that may change, and I'll have more information for you guys on that soon. I just need to point that out. So don't think I'd be adding any additional aero. Let's go ahead and move on to the next question. That's going to be, did you buy your current Corvette brand new or used? I did buy my current Corvette as well as my previous Corvette used. I do try to research the depreciation curve and try to find that sweet spot where you can get the car at, you know, much lower than MSRP, but still have you know, the warranty on the car and it be low mileage and great condition. I was a little bit disappointed later on in the year though when I saw some of the great incentives that were going on the brand new Corvettes. I will point out that if you're going to buy a used Corvette, make sure that you don't just compare it to the sticker price of the brand new models, but you actually do some research and talk to salesmen about some of the incentives that they have going on, because in some cases they may actually be much closer than you think. You could actually get a brand new Corvette of a similar spec that you're looking for not much more than what you'd pay for a used one. So keep that in mind. Not always going to be that way, but again, with my case, there was some really good incentive shortly after I bought my car, and I was kind of kicking myself thinking I could have went with a brand new one for not a whole lot more. Next question we've got here would be, which would you buy, a 6th Gen Z01 or a C7 Z06? For me, this is going to be a really easy question. Definitely the C7 Z06, not only because it is going to be the better performing car in terms of 0 to 60, track times, you know, you name it. It's also the more valuable of the two. So even if you were not, you know, you didn't have a bias towards Corvettes like I do, you know, you're going to obviously go with the more expensive of the two cars if you can choose. But the Z01 is a fantastic car as well. I have reviewed both of these two cars, and I will say that they're both incredible cars, and they actually share a lot of similarities. But the C7 Z06 is definitely going to be my preference. May not be that way for everyone, but it is a faster as well as, like I said, more valuable car. So let's go and move on to the next question. We've got, how come you seem to go with base model Corvettes? Have you ever considered a C6 Z06 or even a C7 Grand Sport or Z06? So this is a good question. And, you know, really, if I'm just being honest with you, it boils down to budget. I would love to have a C7 Z06 or even the upcoming C7 ZR1. But at the time that I purchased my Corvette, you know, the base model Stingray was much more attainable within my budget. Now, I could have definitely gotten for the same price or similar price a C6 Z06. But if you really look into the numbers, a C6 Z06 has similar performance numbers as a C7 Stingray in terms of, you know, 0 to 60 and top speed and all those different variables. The horsepower is a slightly different. You know, the C6 Z06 would have a little bit more. But as far as the refinement and everything that they've done, they're a little bit closer than you might imagine. And for me, you know, having the warranty on the C7, having the newer technology that it came with, I felt like it was a little bit better buy when I went to purchase my car than going with a C6 Z06. But that may not be the case for everyone. You know, there's certainly a really good value, and you can get a lot of performance for a low price point, especially right now on some of the C6 generations, depending on what year you go with. So I hope that answers your question. Next question we've got here would be, would you ever come to Corvette Fun Fest in Effingham, Illinois in September? I live in South Carolina, so I'd love to travel to some different states and go to some car shows, meet up with some of you guys, and go to these cool events. The only problem is, especially if I'm in my Corvette, you can imagine it's just a ton of miles. It's going to be a ton of traveling. I'd have to make time, make sure that I'm able to, I don't know that I necessarily need to miss work, but have to budget my time around work and things like that. So it's difficult for me. I do go to some local car shows. You know, I go to Cars and Coffee here in Greenville, South Carolina, and I would love to make plans in the future, but I'm probably would be more, choosing one to two a year that I travel to rather than consistently going to events out of town or out of state, just simply for the fact of, again, traveling, being able to budget my time, make sure that I'm not just absolutely killing my Corvette with not only daily driving, but also, you know, driving across country and things like that on weekends. But yeah, I would love to go to more events, especially one that's a Corvette dedicated show. I think that would be an absolute blast. So I'd love to come if I can make those arrangements. Next question we've got here is, are you going to put a black hood stinger on your car? This kind of ties back to, you know, the question about the additional aero. I think that the hood stinger stripe looks fantastic. I do think that it's a really good looking addition to any Corvette, especially on a Z06 or a Grand Sport. But even on a Stingray, it really adds some muscle and definition to the hood. But I don't think I'm going to really be doing anything more to my Stingray because I've got my sights set on something else. Granted, a hood stinger stripe is very inexpensive. It's not like a great deal of money put into that I wouldn't be able to get back out. So yeah, I would be open to it. Just need to find time to pick one up and do the installation, maybe do a video for you guys. But yeah, I think it's a really good looking addition to the Corvette. So for our next question, we've got, if you could have any other car other than your Corvette for a daily, what would you get? I think that for me, I would probably go with, say, like a CTS-V with all-season tires on it. You know, something that has four doors, so, you know, in the event that I did want to take more people along for a ride with me, I could, as well as slightly more ground clearance in the front. So yeah, I think a CTS-V would be an awesome option. Either that or maybe something like a Audi RS7, something that's still got a lot of performance, because I wouldn't want to downgrade ultimately to something that is not fun to drive. I do, you know, that's part of why I daily drive my Corvette, is I really enjoy the experience and the thrill that I get from driving it every day. It's just a fun car to be in, and I wouldn't want to go to something that I don't enjoy driving, even if it's just to my commute to work. But so yeah, CTS-V would be awesome, Audi RS7, something along those lines that's a little bit larger, but still offers great performance. Maybe something with all-wheel drive or something that I can easily equip it with all-season tires for winter driving. Next question we've got, and this is kind of similar, but if you could add another vehicle to your lineup for your videos, what would it be and why? So I would love to have, you know, say a C7 ZR1 if that was anywhere near my price range. But, you know, I've talked a little bit earlier in this video about maybe selling my car, maybe another Corvette. I'll give you guys a little sneak peek, I guess you could say. If the C8 is able to, you know, if they're launching that and there's any variant of it that's going to come in under six figures, I'm strongly considering that. I'll leave it at that because, again, we don't know a whole lot about the C8 yet. But if the C8 Corvette does have a variant that's even remotely affordable and under six figures, I'm going to make a very valiant effort to get that car. So I'd love to have that. But, you know, again, those are just two options. There's a whole bunch of cars that I love to make videos on, but I do hope to keep this channel primarily about Corvettes. There's not a whole lot of other cars out there that I would like to get other than a Corvette that I feel like I would enjoy making videos on and that I would be very knowledgeable on, I guess you could say. But really good question. Next one we've got, congrats, man. If you were to restore any classic Corvette, let's say C4 and below, which would you do and why? So this is a really cool question as well. I would definitely choose a C3. Love to have a C3 for a project car here on the channel. I think that you can pick one up for an inexpensive amount, depending on what condition it's in, and it'd be really fun to restore. And I think that they just look great. You know, to me, it's a very authentic Corvette look, and I think that the lines are very exaggerated and just a really cool looking car overall. So to me, that, as well as a C5, you know, C5s were sort of what I grew up loving, you know, as Corvettes. That was the Corvette of my childhood. Obviously, that's not C4 and below, so I'm not going to answer your question with C5, but those are probably the two other generation Corvettes that I'd love to own that I haven't ever owned. It would be a C3 Corvette and a C5 Corvette. So next question, how do you like your Stingray? What would you want to own it as mod-wise? So I know we've talked a lot about modifications on the Stingray. I don't want to, you know, reiterate the same thing that I've said earlier in the video, but I love my Stingray overall. I think that it's a fantastic car. I think that the Stingray is kind of that sweet spot where you get to experience, you know, some of the prestige and some of the value behind owning a Corvette, you know, being a part of that community, but you're not spending a fortune. It's just practical enough where you can daily drive it. And, you know, there's all kinds of advantages to a Stingray and sort of being in that entry level Corvette that I absolutely love. And I'm enjoying the car. I can't say enough about it. And I would recommend one to anyone. Next question. What are your dream cars? And if you could have any job relating to cars other than YouTube, what would it be? So, you know, that's a really good question and definitely kind of gets me thinking. So as far as dream cars go, I think everyone has a attainable dream car and then one that they sort of consider to be not attainable at all. And I would say my attainable one is, again, going to be like a C8 mid-engine Corvette when that comes out, because I can just sort of what I imagine it being is just phenomenal. Or a C7 ZR1 would be an incredible car. Now, as far as the like non-attainable one that I don't realistically think about purchasing, I'd love to have one. Don't want to be negative, but it's not something that I feel like I'm gonna, especially in the next couple of years, even be remotely near buying. But I love the Koenigsegg 1-to-1. I just have a high level respect for that car. I think that you know, it's a smaller company and I can tell there's a lot of passion in that company for cars. It doesn't seem like some big corporate company that's just cranking them out and you know, still making incredible cars, but not a whole lot of passion behind it. And I think that the design is incredible. It's just a beautiful car overall. So that would definitely be my quote unquote non-attainable dream car. As far as a dream job, you know, YouTube is a lot of fun because I have so much freedom on what I post and what I do. I love the fact that I can kind of tailor my content around what it is that I'm, you know, interested in or wanting to do. But I would really love to be involved with production or filming of something that's a little more serious, I guess you could say, like an automotive TV show or an automotive movie, something like that. Or maybe even work for a manufacturer, automotive manufacturer in, say, a sports car division or the performance division for things like market research. You know, you guys know I'm a pretty analytical guy, and that would be something I would really enjoy just because I think it would it'd be a really cool feeling to be involved with the decisions that were made on these cars. So I'd love to do something like that. But anyway, guys, that's pretty much it for the questions today. Thank you again to everyone who submitted questions. I really enjoyed going over those. I hope that you guys enjoyed this video as well. Look forward to doing the next one. Make sure that you're following me on Instagram for an early notification of when the next video will be coming. But we are actually going to be doing a long overdue update to the community cars segment of the video. For those of you that are early subscribers, you know I used to feature other people's cars. I'm going to finally do an update to that today. I haven't done it in a while, and I do apologize, but I'm excited to share some of these with you. I was really surprised by how many of you that watch this channel actually have your own YouTube channels and make phenomenal videos. So in the beginning, I'm going to showcase a couple other creators and channels that reach out to me that follow this channel and make phenomenal videos. So I hope that you guys enjoy this. I'll put a card as well as a link in the description for these other channels. So go check them out. Let them know that you saw their content here on CCNT and that you love it. Go support those guys that make some great videos. But anyway, guys, I'm going to go ahead and make this the outro. I hope you enjoy the community cars segment and have a great day.
Let's break each other's hearts. It's a cold blooded love.